Welcome to this lecture on the topic, what is a philological question? We will pick up on topics that we have treated before, namely this interest in an impersonal kind of figuration, in an impersonal kind of search as well. And we will look more closely at how we could possibly think of such an element of impersonality in philology, and what the relations then between philology and architecture could be. Our main reference, actually, we will stay quite close to this text, to this main reference, is an article by Werner Hamacher, who was a philologist, very important in the sense that he opened up, we could say, philology as a kind of a counter answer, perhaps, to this very general quest in 20th century science that had this inclination to put everything in the light of a general science of language, or a science of language in general, not the so-called linguistic turn. There is something we miss fundamentally about science if we try to pursue this project. This is what Werner Hamacher stands for. He wrote two texts. We will look at them in two separate lectures. Today it will be about the second part, for philology. What it proposes is to think of philology itself as something like language as a public domain, where the question of judgments, or how to value and evaluate, are not being suspended in the sense of put to the side or no longer dealt with, but are being responded to actively in the sense of an advocacy. Philology, in the way that he talks about it, has a lot to do with advocacy, eine Art Fürsprache in German. No? So his texts are originally written in German. We will work here with the English translation. But this is not to say, especially in the case of Werner Hamacher, if you can read the German text. A lot of things always happen in between translations, but we are not in the habit of speaking against translation, but for translation in our context of this course and of other courses too. But nevertheless, the text lives a little bit in another way if you read it in German. So the basis of what we are going to deal with today is the translation of his article with the title For Philology, in a translation by Jason Groves. And before we start, I want to give you some orientation. So, what is the philological question? Is the overall optics in terms of which we are looking at this text by Hamacher. But the lecture will fall. There is a partition spectrum of how we will turn to this question. There even are two partition spectras. Today we deal with the first part of the text. In a later lecture we will deal with the second part. And this first part of the text already is organized such as to fall into four different parts. We will start by thinking about how what is at stake with the question of a philological question is a certain autonomy of language. And it is in this aspect specifically that philology, in the way that we are introduced to it here through Hamacher, is so interesting for architecture, because like architecture, which became very much in the last decades, a kind of it lost a bit its freedom, no? Architecture always has to subject to goals, to aims, to ambitions that are dictated to it from other fields, from sociology, from politics, from economy, from ecology, whatever whatever we can have here. There is at stake an autonomy, the possibility of an autonomy for architecture, and in a similar way, this is at stake in philology for language as well. We will see how this obsession with the science of language has a lot to do with the death of words in the matrix of a mother tongue. We will talk hence about how the violence in this movement can be countered by attributing a nature to language, so not only a death but also a birth to language, and how such a birth can be captured in the term of an anarchic movement, of an anarche, so of an absence of an origin, of an absence of an origination, and how this element of an absence of origination, of an anarche, provides or is necessary to make room for providing something that we could perhaps best call a language public. No? So a language public is not the same like a language in general that would hence be public. It is not the same like a formal language. It is also specifically not the same like a semantic ontology. We will see how this autonomy in the case of language relates a lot to an autonomy that separates language from the meaning which it always articulates. So there is an autonomy to language because it maintains active relations to the meanings that it seeks to preserve, to articulate, and to figure out. So then let's start by jumping in. This is the first paragraph of his text. It starts by pointing out that there is an anti-philological affect today. Not this statement, so there is an anti-philological affect today. This is a kind of a, where do we start from? It's a kind of a diagnostic sentence. It's in a way the claim or also a postulation which the whole text that we're going to talk about seeks to answer to. Yeah? And the question then is, of course, how can it seek an autonomy of its own for philology by rendering itself the subject to a question which is posed from elsewhere? And this is at the core of the cunning, you could say, with which this text is thought and written, because it turns this very question. So there is an anti-philological affect. How could one possibly respond to that? No? Into the question of philology itself. So what is a philological question? This is how Hamacher proposes to answer to this Zeitdiagnostic observation, let's say, or a sentiment. He writes, to explain how he means this anti-philological affect. More and more among the human sciences, philology is seen as a petty, a narrow, an elitist, and in extreme cases hostile enterprise of specialists who presume to practice as a profession what any literate person does naturally. This affect, hostility towards concentrated attention to language, words, and pauses, turns into a defensiveness and often to disdain across the wide public. And the affect is also shared by many philologists, fueled as it is by energies closely related to those of philology. For philology, no matter how entrenched in the academy, is not a discipline. Yeah? So this is the first cue we need to take very serious. Philology is not to be a discipline. Not to be a discipline means it doesn't cover a territory. It doesn't cover a finite territory of things that would fall within its domain and things that would remain outside of it. So philology, and this we will look closely at, needs to maintain relations to a sort of a totalizing gesture. And this is indeed the crucial challenge also that we need to cope with. He further writes, philology is not only or even primarily for scholars and pedagogues. Even before academics can lay claim to it, philology must already be practiced by anyone who speaks, anyone who thinks or acts by speaking, and anyone who attempts to bring light and indeed to interpret these and others' actions, gestures, and poses. Whoever speaks and whoever acts in order to be able to speak and act does philology, even if it's called by another name. So philology is not a discipline, but it is an activity. It is something that is active, and we will see how this activity consists in being actively passive for. No, actively, it has to do with something euphoric, it has to do with something that lives from a spiritedness, something that cannot be positively put as a substance. But then just what is it? Yeah, what fuels philology? So he explains further, for in the sphere of language, nothing is self-evident and so much needs elucidation, commentary, and elaboration. Philology always finds something further to add. And this is a crucial index. So it's not a discipline, it's not a finite territory. It doesn't have a cause outside of itself. So what moves it must remain or to be found inside of itself. And this comes from philology being something which always finds something further to add. So it's a totalizing gesture that can never keep up with itself, you could say. This is an idea which is not entirely new. So many writers, fiction writers, literary writers as well have responded to this, Borges, for example. It's the idea that every language can always say everything that can be said. Yeah. But from being able to say everything that can be said, it can also speak about what it is that it has to say and so on. So there is a kind of an escalation a spiral movement. And the peculiarity of this spiral movement, and this Ricardo Villa has shown nicely in his last lectures, is of a double, gesture. So it moves towards, it moves now upwards the spiral towards an escalation, but at the same time downwards towards a concentration, or a de-escalation, we could also say. And what philology tries to capture in this understanding here is how this double movement doesn't come one after the other, but simultaneously, at one and the same time. And because it does this, it is possible to pick up this affect, this anti-philological affect, and concentrate on it. So trying to respond to it, trying to grasp what it says affirmatively, not by disputing it, not by saying, but it is not true, many people have still always loved philology, and so on. It is not moving in the order of arguments. That is very crucial about philology. But then how does it move? How does it move? How is such movement that always seeks to include what is in addition to itself? Yeah. It's the movement of an augmentation. It's the movement which can never be fulfilled. It's a movement which can never really come to a stop. So it is in touch with an indefiniteness, we will see, but that is another issue. Here, what is at stake is a kind of an infiniteness. Yeah, but it's an infinite, and that's where it becomes very important that this infiniteness is a gestural one. It's one which is a doing, an activity, but an activity which doesn't realize its content, but which is quick and alive in itself. Yeah, it's a gesturing, if you want, which is dramatic. That's why the suggestion is that philology opens up a language public. In a language public, it is never substance, it is never properties that are at stake, but it is a civic kind of mutual codependence and coexistence that is being cultivated and cared for through such a kind of a gestural activity, in which the substances are precisely what is always encoded, what is always bracketed out, and what can therefore always be attended to anew. So the claim is very radical. Hamacher says that philology always finds something further to add, not only to the particular, not only to a particular idea, thing, name, statement, text, but also to the universal itself. So the element in which philology lives or is quick is the universal, hence it is of universality, but it can never contain the universal. It always finds something further to add to the particular as well as to the universal. So he says philology is the gesture of a furthermore that can never be superfluous, because it is the movement of speaking itself, overriding everything already spoken and still to be spoken. Philology, for which the most general things must become a problem, is the super general, a longing for language, for everything grasped by it and everything it could still touch, a longing that recoils from every totality and which, speaking for another and yet another, critiques everything that has been achieved and that can be achieved. So it is of an order of a generality, that means eine Allgemeinheit, so something which pertains to things in general, but not as a science. This we will work out. Not as a science. Science itself is what philology pertains to. Philology, he says, so if philology is not primarily concerned with concepts, it is concerned with words, with the movement of words itself, with the movement of speaking which can never, speech has a relation to presence. We can never really speak in the past. We can only, we can do many things, but we cannot speak in the past. Yeah. Speaking is the thing which establishes a presence, perhaps foremost of all the things. So speech is completely, it goes away immediately, no? It's a bit like time, no? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 seconds. It's a bit like time. It has a relation to time, which has a lot to do with counting, but a counting which and that is the clue, which Hamacher is aiming at, it's a counting for which the numbers are not given as a concept. So philology must be the one thing that does not come under any concept, but nonetheless that which no concept can do without. Philology is the precarious movement of speaking about language above and beyond every given language. It does not guarantee knowledge, but it renews its postponement, does not offer consciousness, but indicates manifold possibilities for its deployment. So, and the danger that philology always meets, if one thinks of it in this way, is that it solidifies into epistemic techniques. If it does, it loses its connection to the quickness. It loses its connection to the real lifetime, the action, the time of the action. This is what lives from an affective relationship. Hamacher foregrounds, philology is an affective relationship with a philia, a friendship with or befriending of language, and moreover, a relationship to a language with no firm contours, no consistent form, and not yet an instrument of meanings fixed in advance. It is a groping, a seeking, a probing movement. This again is the movement of speaking. Yeah? It is a groping, a seeking, a probing movement. Philology is not primarily the agent of statements about stable states of affairs. It is rather a prime mover of questions. Yeah? So if philology is this movement of speaking itself, decoupled or detached distanced, alienated, we also could say, from the content that it articulates, the things that it grasps in its words. If speaking itself can be a search, what is it directed at? No? How to think of this intransitivity? And with respect to this, how to think of the movement of speech to an intransitivity in terms of its objects, Hamacher suggests that philology is the prime mover of questions as such. So questions which are not questions that pose a problem well, or that put an object at stake, or that address a state of affairs, all of these would be gestures that deal with content. Rather, it is a prime mover of questions, something like the source of action in speaking. So in order to speak, we must always already behave and be philological. Yeah? So in this sense, we can see he refutes, that's one first gesture, to refute the validity of this affect, which says that philology wants to turn a certain way of behaving in language, of relating to language, into a specialist and an elitist kind of thing, into a thing which most of the people would be excluded from, would be deprived from. Rather, he says, no, it's not like this, it's exactly the opposite. Philology is the very air we breathe, so to speak, while speaking. So when we are speaking, we are being philologists. But nevertheless, precisely because this is so, we need to attend closely to the kind of concentration that it affords, because it is a concentration that does not focus transitively on an object. It is a concentration that is being lived, like embodied and lived, like a body, no? Like a body itself. Perhaps, we could say. I'm not sure. So, it's a prime mover, a prime movement, but it's a prime mover which is different from a prime mover that would judge, not like a first judge. So like a creator, every creator is a first judge. A creator creates things through articulating and stating them. This is the idea of a divine law, no? of a law, even a natural law, a law that would consist in jurisdiction that is transitive. Jurisdiction that speaks right about everything. Yeah. Philology is the inverse movement to that. Philology also plays in the field of jurisdiction, but it takes the role of the advocacy. So one way to think of what philology does, according to what I would like to present to you here, is that philology acts in advocacy of the things which are being transitively objectified, which are being conceived objectively, which are being put forward and articulated and reflected and exposed. Yeah? So philology needs to speak as the advocate of this. But to speak as the advocate of this, of the objective, no, it needs to always ask as fundamentally as it can, what were the assumptions in terms of which a thing has come to be objectified. So he writes, philology is the advocate of this restriction. And the restriction refers to philology restricts its movement on behalf of them, no? Also on behalf of communication, of a completed communication. So philology is the advocate of this restriction for which and through which there can be language in the first place. It must therefore defend itself against its own prevailing definitions, while at the same time protecting itself against every agenda for its future practice. Philology poses questions, and when it makes claims, it is only to invite further questions. And here is a great term now, no? It is a structurally ironic procedure. So a structurally ironic procedure. This means there is a structure to its procedure. That's what I would call its gesturing, no? It's gesturing, it's categorical, Haltung geben, Haltung nehmen. But there is an irony to this structural gesturing. And an irony means a stepping next to itself. Yeah? So in philology, one is never, so it can attend to the movement of speech because one is never oneself speaking. We will see how this entails that for the philological questions, it is crucial that others ask the question. Yeah, so then out of this results, of course, the peculiar relationship that philology maintains to other complexes, linguistic complexes, so in particular to the so-called exact sciences. On, because then philology is in relation to them on principle, so the first mover of language, of speech. So on principle, it is an unprincipled and anarchical relationship. Yeah? So that is because it doesn't have its own domain. So it doesn't have its own origin either. So it is the first mover, but this first mover depends upon everything else. So it is not the movement which it can trigger is not in its own control. This is a very important aspect. And like this, philology has relations to what we call a certain kind of mechanics, no? In the sense of it is not, in order to act as an advocacy, as an advocate, it needs to take into account all sides, no? If only to understand what it needs to speak for. Hamacher writes, philology speaks for a for that makes room for a pro as much as a contra. Beyond both, it is the movement through which they can be questioned, through which philology itself and its questions can be put in question. So, but then how more properly can we, more graspably or more understandably perhaps, can we think about what kind of question that would be? So, what I want to propose is to think of it as questions, not in terms of essences or of substance, no? It's a question which is not ever meant to be answered in substance, but in gesture. And gesture, what does gesture establish? A kind of an identification, we could say, which is entirely exterior. No? Gesture affects us, but it doesn't ask for consent. It's like in a dance, no? One can respond to a move with through gesture. So what gesture establishes is the identification in the terms of something we could best call a familiarity. And this is indeed how Hamacher starts this paragraph. He says, when you are unfamiliar with something and you feel you should turn your attention to it to get to know it, I'm reading here, you will ask yourself or someone else what it might be, this thing. You can pose this question explicitly or implicitly only when the unfamiliar object of your question is already there, even obtrusively there, while at the same time unfamiliar and inaccessible. This singular circumstance, a thing singled out as both obtrusive and inaccessible, corresponds to the linguistic form of the question, what might it be? Yeah. And this also is a very important point. If you think, no, so there is a kind of a naivety which tries to tell us, you know, questions are very innocent. The question is an opening, but no, not only in situations of an exam, but also in situations of an interrogation, for example. No, and you can think of, I don't know, a love affair which doesn't go well. No, and people start to ask each other, are you still in love? Yeah. So there is something obtrusive with it. So if things are not going well, putting this not being well to the point that one question articulates is a closure. It's the gesture of a closure. So how, and this is at the core of this philological approach, how could a question actually embody an opening gesture? No. How could it embody an opening gesture? Precisely by abstracting from an object, yeah. So from it's a kind of an asking questions that in asking listens, no? That doesn't try to direct responses, to focus concerns, but that completely exhausts itself in absorbing, in picking up, in picking up as many factors as possible of the situation, of the singular circumstance, let's say. So, for the question directs itself towards something, so this is the naive sense again, yeah? The question directs itself towards something, to a this, without being able to follow its path to the end and grasp the ultimate object of inquiry. Just as the thing that provokes this kind of question is simultaneously obtrusive and inaccessible, every question that responds to this provocation is itself an obtrusive, often impertinent, and yet obstructed approach to its goal. Nothing changes in this internal division of the question if the object of inquiry is a linguistic construct rather than a thing, for example, a sentence or an institution made out of language, such as an appointment, a law, a complex communicative relationship, a society, or even a culture. Nothing changes in the double movement of the question when it directs itself towards those institutions, philology, for example, or philosophy, that pursue the analysis, and thereby also the question of language. In all of these cases, he concludes here, in all of these cases, question and thing remain in the balanced relationship of a face-to-face that ensures their interrelation as well as their distance. So what is at stake is another kind of relationship, one that is more intimate, one that is also more existential, so one in which one can never really say, I am I. Yeah? Or you are you. So this is what is at stake with a question, if a question is indeed meant to be a gesture of opening rather than one of dominance. And for this reason only, can we say there is something like a form to questions, or questions itself. Questions themselves go pregnant, perhaps best, with a kind of form. So, as much as it might appear to unsettle things, the question, I'm reading here, the question of who or what something is, of its structure or essence, is always also a gesture of protection in which the form of the question safeguards itself. So the form, question itself as a form, yeah, that's the idea, question itself as a form which does not only mean to expose an object or to comprehend an object, but just as much to protect itself, to safeguard itself. It's a kind of a mask. And in this aspect of a mask, it appears as obtrusive. There is a violence to it. Yeah. So it's a closing off before it can be an opening up to. And the question then is, why should philology affirm, try to seek an affirmative relation to questions, to questions that can be called philological questions, with the claim that those questions alone are capable of providing an opening, of making room, as Hamacher calls it later, we will see. Yeah. So it should be a questioning which tries to undo its very form. No? So a questioning which radically exposes itself, that is why the question of what is a philological question is the question of foundations, but not in the sense of helping to support an order, no? No, like fixing an auxiliary structure where it begins to tremble and grow weak, a certain order. Not like this, but really open. So the foundational questions. Because only through that can they find another relation to the order which is being looked at. The way he puts this is that every possible question, even the question of ground and goal, of sense, meaning and form, every why, what for, how, and therefore the very form of the question itself is placed in question, such that even the minimum certainty afforded by wondering and searching is shattered. It is hence a catastrophe of questioning. So the philological question, so the questioning of the status of a question in philology, this is a catastrophe of questioning, but it is simultaneously a catastrophe of language in the act of questioning and a catastrophe of language in general. The form of questioning itself, and not an external thing, has become both unfamiliar and obtrusive, and hence provokes the question concerning it. Yet this self-provocation of questioning coincides with its self-obstruction. And here we begin to see what is worthwhile about this this line of thinking. What one yields from it is a kind of a mechanism of alienation, which is suspending the difference between same and other, no? Rather than comprehending it in a certain way through mimesis, for example, or also through simulation, or also through whatever kind of substitute order, it is capable of keeping it in discorded balance, something like this. In an entropy state, we could say. And this is worthwhile because it's the only way to perform something like self-provocation, no? Or self-obstruction. So if philology is the mover, the prime mover of all questions, then the questions are what comes from outside, the transitive, the object of the question, they are what comes from the outside, but the question, what moves the question itself, must come from the inside, from within philology. And it comes through philology becoming something else in the moment when it picks up, when it responds to, when it speaks in relation to questions, that it picks up. Hamacher speaks of this as, this is a German word game, which in English I probably cannot reproduce, ein verandertes. So it's almost like the term verändertes, but the term verändertes would be something transformed, something which has become something else. Yeah? And it is precisely this dialectics which is being kept in suspension by philology. That's what he means to say. And that means consequently that it cannot be about the transformation of a thing. It must be about a thing becoming, so still remaining itself and yet already being other than itself. So das andere is the other, something which is being transformed into an othering, we could say, but this also is too linear, no? It's not a continuous movement from same to other. It is precisely the grasping of the suspension of it. That is what the form of the question in philology stands for. And it is also why the question in philology can never really have any form at all. In order to find in form the categories that can keep suspended this relation between self and other. No? And the other is ein verandertes. It's something which has been othered. That's how we need to refer to it. It's not the other versus the self. It's a self versus a self. But this, both of these selves have been subjected to an othering. So it's an othered self. There is a crisis. It's a split. We will see it's a split self. Philology itself is split. In essence, it's not one. It's not whole. It's not an identity. That's why we have this relation to the impersonal in philology. And that which it relates to, for this goes the same. So there are many sames, let's say. We will see that this relates to the many languages, the many speeches. All of them are a singular same, but what philology does is it brings them to become, well, to add to themselves what they don't yet comprehend. No, it's an othering that comes through through this, he called it super generalization. So the totalizing gesture which needs to include what always remains to be added to it. That's at the core of this term, verandertes, ein verandertes Selbst. So it becomes discernible that the question itself is split, duplicated in itself, an antagonistic complex. Yeah. So the question is not one part in an antagonistic conflict, but the question itself becomes the stage of an antagonistic complex, and not only the stage of it, but the public space in which antagonistic complexes can be carried out. So he writes, whoever asks the question, what is a question, can hardly doubt that he does something or lets something called questioning happen. But he will probably be in the dark as to what it is supposed to be that he does or lets happen when he asks this. He asks about an unknown what, in which the that of its fulfillment is supposedly stabilized into an object. What the question ought to be is a movement towards an unknown something, but now the unknown something resides in the question itself, and the movement that should have led to something else is now directed towards the movement itself. This is the movement of speaking, he would say, which is in touch with philology as the prime mover of all questions. Like this, the question not only directs attention outwardly of our spiral towards something else, but through orienting it towards something else, it concentrates it to itself. But from having engaged with this other out here, it meets itself as an other too. Yeah? So there is this splitting movement happening. So that means that the question, and as such, so the this quest of the unknown reveals that the movement is indeed completed, but precisely for this reason it cannot be made into an object of its own cognition. So the one who completes a movement of a question, no, who arrives at himself as an other through having engaged with something other, is no longer the self. So the self, which can say, I am now another, can never explain or take as its object, as the object of its own cognition, what it is in this moment. No? Rather, it has to start out again and again and again and again. So it's always in it. So the philological question is when it is by sich, no, at its own, it is not one. As soon as it becomes one, it is no longer at its own. It is no longer a philological question. It is a philological question helping to resolve a problem in another field. It becomes a servile discipline whenever the philological question rests in a self. No, it's not split. Another formulation of how he puts this: the question still asks what the question already is. Yeah? Also, the question has been answered, one has arrived at oneself, yet as another. And then to conceive of this change would be to ask again the same question. Yeah? And that is when questioning become transitive, when they become obtrusive, and when they are not an opening but an act of violence. So this is a description which helps perhaps to relate to picture, to sense, to be affected by this strange kind of relation. Hamacher writes, "The peculiar aspect of questioning after the question consists in the fact that in every here and now it is ahead of itself. And since divided from itself, it also falls short, fails to correspond to itself, each time running out ahead of its truth, conceived within the correspondence theory of truth." No. So if it is conceived within the correspondence theory of truth, so if a question has an answer and the question corresponds to an answer, which is put as an object, so the question is no longer necessary, that is how we usually think, it's called the correspondence theory of truth. If we would stay within that theory, then the question would always be ahead of itself. It would always be divided from itself, and it could never fall into one place where it could rest. Yeah? So the question is obtrusive now, also in an existential sense. So the question, so one cannot do away with philology or with its movement of questioning, even if one tried to perfect a correspondence theory of truth. Good. Let's look closer at this sense of an othered self. The way that Hamacher relates to this is the term self-exendence. Yeah, and here you can perhaps best grasp the very strange fabric of this relationality. Yeah, so self-exendence is a term that is not usually, it doesn't have a stable meaning. It's a term that Hamacher coins in this moment. And he coins it by making it like other terms which we know, but changing them. So the usual term which we relate to such othering would be transcendence or transcendentality. And trans precisely describes leaving one state and arriving in another state. But what Hamacher is interested in is leaving what one knows has never been a state and not yet arriving in what one knows can never be a state. So it's this moment of suspension. So it cannot be a trance. Yeah? There is not a passage. It cannot be a trance. It is an X, a moving out, a stepping next to oneself, an exendence. That relates to the self, yeah? So it's a stepping next to oneself without being either something other or an altered or a transformed self. But he will say the suffering of being split, the suffering of not being whole. So the passion, we will see his understanding is that philology is in essence pathology. So it's a suffering. And the suffering comes from this, or is grasped in this idea of a self-exendence. He says, the event of this exendence, of questioning, does not let itself be reduced to a substance. That's the core. So to be, but not only, that's one way perhaps you could think as well. So to be of substance, but substance doesn't exhaustively capture it. So he writes, the question does The question exists not by transcending itself towards a commensurate other, but rather by going out of itself and beyond itself and ultimately transiting towards itself as an inconceivable other, and thus perhaps to a not other and remaining in transit. So this is the moment. The suspension is a remaining in transit, but it is of a direction, of course, and the direction would be in the direction of oneself as an inconceivable other. So, but if questioning is not concerned with substance, with essence, then questioning can take on no finite form, and so no form at all, that cannot be questioned and thereby set out of action. It is possible that these movements are also at work in the apparently simpler forms of predication and imperative. So forms, that means question would be a form, predication, that means qualifying a subject, giving a name to a thing, would be a form, and imperative is also a form. It is the form that dictates what is to be done, an imperative. It has a dictating character, a law character. All of these are forms, but they are all finite forms. That's what Hamacher tries to expose. Whereas the questioning, if we understand of it as philological questioning, is the only, formality in language, because clearly it is a formality, otherwise we couldn't speak of questioning, it would be of no form, it would be only gesturing or babbling. Also, I'm not sure, probably for gesturing one could argue quite likewise. But what he tries to say is, yes, it is of a form, but it's not a finite form. And that's what makes questioning different from other forms of language, the simple forms of language. And out of this comes a claim which seems to affirm, if you want, this linguistic term, but it only seems to. No, it's not really. He says, since there are questions only in language, and that's now the thing. So to have a form, which is not finite, that is peculiar to questioning, and it is what relates philology with questioning in an intransitive way. No? So to be engaged with form in a public also, the question is to provide room, not to decide actions, but to provide room for coexistence. And in the same sense, the relation between question and philology are worthy, of value, are interesting. And if this is so, then we need to respect that questions are only in language, be it a language of gestures, of conduct, of social organization. The question concerning the question is, in each of its movement, a question concerning language. So at this now, that is one of the difficult things. How does this not mean then that language is a kind of an imperialism over everything else? And it would if it were concerned with content, but it is not concerned with content. No. So there is a universality to language which is not hegemonic. Which is not hegemonic because this language is not a discipline, it doesn't have a field, it doesn't have a domain. But it is not itself treating concepts, but it is what every form of conception in whichever discipline there is needs to deal with. Yeah. So it's a categorical status. That is what categories are. Categories are things that apply to everything at all. So the classical categories pertain to space and to time. So everything necessarily has a place in time and a place in space. So two things cannot coexist in the same place. for example, but it also means that everything must maintain relations to another and to itself. This is all Aristotle. This is the first articulation of a table of categories. So categories mean they are what applies to all things. And categories are were invented in rhetoric and in court. Yeah. So the law, jurisdiction as a practice, is the main achievement of the sophists. So of rhetorics in public space, and what the law crucially tries to settle is how is a thing properly addressed. So what is an adequate way of addressing a thing? And this is where the term to kategori, yeah, I don't know how to pronounce it in Greek, to categorize. This is the term that comes from there. And the idea with categories is that there must be things which are universally applicable to everything. Otherwise, we wouldn't speak of law, we would speak of rules, we would speak of traditions, we would speak of customs. But when we speak of law, it must be universal. Otherwise, we cannot speak of law. So the categories are what makes the idea of law universal. But the categories then are what one never has, but what one develops in thinking. And then the question that we are confronted with here is, how does such thinking relate to questioning? So there is no way to bypass language. That's what he means to say here. But he enlarges language, yeah? Language of conduct, of gestures. It would be interesting how he would relate to information theory and the physics of information. So then there are several senses, and senses means directions, no? That we can take with respect to what is a philological question. And they are, on the one hand, the question concerning a certain question type, classified as philological, so that is what is at stake. And of it, he says, it can be understood not only as a limit on the question concerning the question, but moreover as a distraction from its significance as a question. It's again this spiraling movement. So it's concerning the question, but it's a distraction from the signification of the question. He says, up for debate, I'm reading here in the blue part now, up for debate is the philological question. In the philological question is a technical, a disciplinary problem, already defined and also always requiring further definition. This debate has pre-established historical parameters and only allows for procedural answers internal to the discipline. And then he says, but the question concerning the philological question can be understood in still another sense. Yeah. So it's not only the case that a question needs to, so philology relates to another discipline, because it must be from outside that the questions are picked up. Not the, also philology picks up the question from elsewhere, but it doesn't address or concern itself with the substance of what is at stake in these questions, but with the form, in order to keep this form infinite, so to keep the form of the question itself in question. So the question concerning the philological question can be understood in still another sense. That is to say, he says, this question implies that philology defines itself in the first place through its questions, and thus neither by means of a particular range of objects nor by means of what used to be called worldviews and what are now known as cultural presuppositions, convictions, or beliefs. Here you have another aspect of this universality which is at stake. If there were not such a universality, then we could say, well, it's something like an aspect logics, yeah? So what philology tries to foreground here with the question of the question is nothing really different from saying, well, one point of view versus another point of view, yeah? Or one set of aspects versus another set of aspects. But any of these Would be concerned with precisely what he claims here is not the case for philology. They would be concerned with worldviews, with supposition, with presuppositions, with convictions or with beliefs. But rather, he says, in philology and in philology only, the status of the question is one which liberates. So he says the question in philology, because it doesn't concern itself with something of substance, makes possible an emancipation from the doxae of other disciplines, from techniques of knowledge and from modes of experience, thereby allowing it, at least in principle, to detach. Yeah, I'm sorry, I don't have the full sentence here. But the crucial point is this a promise of emancipation. Yeah? So the question, which says there is not a question which could not or should not be put into question, is a liberating movement, and it's liberating not by exposing a self as an autonomous self. So the self of this questioning is always a split one. It's one that has become other, is not really itself, but what makes it worth to do that is an emancipation from the doxae of the other disciplines. So philology itself is not a discipline, but it is dependent upon, and it provides room. This is how I want to work it out. It provides room for disciplines to coexist. But the disciplines all have their techniques of knowledge, their modes of experience, and their doxae, so their teachings. Yeah. So their foundational assumptions. And they can only progress because they don't continuously question the foundational assumptions. So to question the foundational assumptions means to give a rest, to put a halt to a progressing, advancing movement. And that is also, of course, what philology does. Yeah, philology relates a progressing movement with where it is coming from. So a future with the past. But in a different way from how history does this. No, because it keeps, if you want, the present, which is the place of contingency between past and future. And I call it contingency because contingency literally comes from tingere, that means to be in touch, but also to be pierced through. But to be in touch with where future and past are in touch with one another. This is the place which philology wants to keep in suspension, such as to be able to make room for coexistence. So, this is a kind of a recapitalizing slide. What is interesting here is that he brings in the Baron von Münchhausen. It's a story where somebody gets stuck in the mud. Yeah, the mud is a quicksand. So he's sinking, he's drowning in the ground, drowning alive in the ground. And the story of the Baron von Münchhausen is a comic story where this one person to whom this happens is actually capable to lift itself out of it by grasping its hair, its own hair, and pulling. Yeah? And of course, it is the image for the idea that it were possible, if an order is collapsing, it should be possible to provide from within this one order which is collapsing support for the order to coexist a little bit longer. Yeah. So that is what he wants to push out. So when it happens that in whatever disciplines the orders lose their foundational power, no, their capacity to provide order, it is not possible to support this one order from within the logics of itself. And in every one of these situations, what we have to turn to is philology. It's always philology. So he says, in this sense, it is adequate to say that philology has a serving character. So it is It is something with its own autonomy, and yet what it does is it helps. It can be called to help. It can be called to support, yeah, like an advocate, like a lawyer, like somebody who speaks for the accused. Yeah. So the order itself is becoming weak, is trembling, is collapsing. Philology can help this order to win an other relation to itself, yeah? One that it couldn't develop out of itself, this discipline. That is the idea here. So to sum up, he says, yeah, philology, there is an autonomy to it, even so, it depends on others. So that is the difficult thing. Yeah, philology doesn't have its own field, it is not a discipline, and yet it has an autonomy. And this autonomy consists in being able to provide Hinweisung. Hinweisung is not the same like direction. Hinweisung is calling attention to. Yeah, it's much softer. And Hinweis, no, to may I call to your attention? No? That would be perhaps a formulation for it. And this is active. This is a movement. It's a movement which can be called for, and it's a movement which manifests as a medium for a publicness, I would say, for a publicness. So that means that the disciplines don't become proprietary. So the disciplines they need to coexist with each other. No, chemistry needs to coexist with physics. We know that they are always striving for hegemony over one another. Physics claims to that chemistry wouldn't be a known subject because physics itself can explain all of it in chemistry, and the other way around. And then biology, is biology now to be regarded in terms of chemistry or in terms of physics? It's a big dispute. So these are all conflicts that arise between disciplines whose orders are no longer providing the support they should. And philology provides to such proprietary arrangements, let's say, between the disciplines among themselves, a domain of publicness. And this domain of publicness manifests in the relation that philology has to codings, yeah. So to codings of the terms. So he proposes here a difference between a mature meaning, so a meaning that would be the meaning of an adult, so it would be the meaning administrated by an authoritative institution, whereas a philology would be das unmündige Kind, so it's an autonomy but not a self-responsibility. And this, of course, would be to address philology itself as a discipline, which is precisely what he says we shouldn't do. Because if we would do it, if we would say, well, philology is something like an infant or a child, not yet grown into a discipline, then it would be a child which is always already dead in the arms of what protects it. Because it would be a derivative to another order. Okay, with this we are at the end of the first part. The other three parts will be much shorter, and I hope much less repetitive. So I wanted to convey to you a little bit the mood also of what it entails, because one can easily say, what is it to question every question, but how to feel its affect? Yeah, that is a complicated thing. So we continue now with the aspect of the quickness or the liveliness of language in philology by going to this second part. So, and here, what is interesting is he begins to speak of the death of the word in meaning. So the death of the word in meaning. So the word, on the one hand, is a little bit like this child, which is not yet of age, which is unmündig, like this child. But this child, if it is considered unmündig, then this child has never really been alive. Yeah. So, but it, rather, it is being, it is dying. It is dying in the language from which it has been born. So in the mater, he calls it the mother text, the mater text. And this, of course, that's where this idea of a publicness is coming from, because we usually relate to language through a mother tongue, yeah. And then there would be a kind of an immediate continuity of one and the same tongue that is being spoken from mother to child, to child to child to child, yeah. But for the philologist, the speaking can only reveal itself as a movement of speaking if it manifests itself in a writing, and that's why he makes this parallelity between a mother tongue and the mother text. He says if a tongue that is being spoken would the words of this tongue, so the words that are being spoken, would never be set free from the text where they might have been born or where they are originating from, then the words die in the all-powerful matrix of meaning. And this is what he relates to the phantasm of semanticism. So the phantasm of semanticism is the idea that the definitions of words, the meanings of the fields of associations of words can be cartographed. No, can like the countries of the world, so they can be delineated in its territory and put next to each other. Yeah, and that would be this domain, this deadly domain of an all-powerful matrix of a matter text, as he calls it. So, and it is hard to refute, but yeah, we don't go into this now. That's too destructive. He plays with this idea of the Vormundschaft, of the guardianship, of the. It's interestingly that in German, what is at stake is Mündigkeit. So there is literally the term of the mouth, being able to have a voice and to speak up, is there. And in the English language, usually the way that this would be translated is coming of age. Yeah? So to come of age. And of course, it's the age where one is self-responsible. One no longer is protected by a guardianship. So philology is, in a strange way, a language which is not yet of age. But not because it will be one day, but because it can only be itself as long as it is not. Yeah. So it's a language which provides the possibility for an ethics without being capable of being called to responsibility. So philology can be responsive to questions put up everywhere else in a way that facilitates an ethical engagement. But this entails that it itself cannot be subjected to the order, to the domain of an order of another discipline. So it needs to have an autonomy. He says there is let's make it short perhaps and simply stay with the picture. And the picture that he gives here is that of a child, which is more than the dumb extension of its predecessors and guardians, yeah? So self-evidently. And if we say that in language there is a quickness, there is an autonomy, there is a kind of a liveliness to language, then whenever it is born, whenever it is starting something new, it is clearly to be regarded as being more than a dumb extension of its predecessors and guardians. It is a novum, another kind of inception, and the inception of another kind. Yeah. So this is something that we should grant a language to. So, and then there is an interesting a play of publicness which is being started. Yeah, he says, so too for every word, and so too for its advocate, philology. They must, in order to be able to speak for others, themselves begin to speak. So this maybe brings the very intricate and convoluted and complicated relations best to a point. What is at stake is how to speak for others without either serving and pleasing them or being dominated by them. Yeah? How to speak for others as an act of keeping self faithful. Or I don't know whether this is the right word. So for keeping an authentic relation to oneself. So speaking for others in order to keep an authentic relation to oneself, like the advocate does. He speaks for the accused, but he gets not compromised by this. No? At least the idea of the advocate is capable of this tense action. So what this crucially implies is that the philological question cannot be understood as a scientific question. Yeah. And because of that, because it is not a scientific question, it can never take the form of a scientific question. Because if it would, its form would not be infinite, its form would be finite. And what this entails is that everything that must count as non-knowledge would just be a form of not yet knowledge. Let me see if I confuse something here. Hamacher writes, so it can never be, a philology can not be a science. Thus understood, it already contains as a question the answer. It isn't one. Were there fundamental principles of philology as a science, then the question about philology would not be allowed to belong to it, since the question indicates non-knowledge or not yet knowledge. Okay, yeah. So if philology were a science, then there would be a set of fundamental principles that come from elsewhere than philology. And if this were so, then philology would no longer be able to have questions in this fundamental sense that I try to develop up until now. It could not ask questions that were opening. It would only ask questions that are agonistic, not that play a part in an agonistic setup, not that provide and integrate an agonistic situation of discourse. So where speech is only used as an instrument and cannot unfold a movement of its own. And whereas the unfolding of a movement of its own, this is the generous aspect of language. Now if it is used as an instrument, then this is the purposeful, the useful, the finite, and that means also the violent use of language, which Hamacher tries to counter. No, he started by saying there is an anti-philological affect today. Yeah. So this anti-philological affect results from the claim that philology tries to make something which is natural and generally available to everybody who speaks the domain of a proper elite, of a specialized class. But this withholding or this withdrawal of philology, while at the same time saying it is completely natural and belongs to everybody, has to do with this reservedness towards being regarded as a science, which would deprive it of its strength. So, but deprive it of its strength doesn't mean that it is a kind of a war machine, a machinery, no, a discipline, an organized force. Perhaps it is, but if it is, it's in an inverse sense. So what Hamacher says that philology is essentially embarrassed. So it's essentially embarrassed for lacking an answer to the question that it puts, no? To the question of what it does. So philology's embarrassment at lacking an answer to the question of what it does is not merely the passing malaise of a discipline that awaits its definition and thereby its redemption. Rather, he says, embarrassment at not knowing and perhaps never knowing what it does. This is philology. So, and now the focus point with which we want to go on. The question is then what, so philology is embarrassed because it can never say what it does or what it is. But the question then is, is this kind of a philological question, is it a counter question? Is it a question that counters authority? Is it a question that counters science? That's how he ends here. Can a philologist, insofar as he speaks as a philologist, pose this question? And this question is, one poses the counter question, from whom, from what authority, and with what right can this question ever be posed? Yeah, so the philologist who asks a philological question, we will see that this is we will see that the development that Hamacher proposes is that the philologist who asks the philological question can only ask a question as a philological question if he asks it as a counter question. And a counter question means for whom, from what authority, and with what right can a question ever be posed? So it needs to come to be in touch with the problem, let's say, that gives rise to a question. And this is only possible as long as philology is the experience of a philia, only an inclination, an emotion that intensifies. Yeah. So he says philology finds no foothold in the knowledgeable, and that therefore, and it therefore moves in the passages. So philology moves in the passages; it finds no foothold. And in that sense, he says philology is a pathology. So there is a double movement to it. And this double movement, it's a kind of, I imagine it a bit like a pump. Yeah? A pump which must be sustained by something outside of it. So it's a helix, no? A dynamic helix which goes in two directions. And in that, it is also the case that philology maintains the closest affinities to mesology. Yeah. So in insisting to ask a question without saying why, for whom, what is the legitimacy, what is the purpose of it, it maintains extremely close relations to mesology. And mesology, this is, as Wikipedia tells us, defined as the hatred of reason, the revulsion or distrust of logical debate, argumentation, or the Socratic method. The source of the word is Plato's dramatic work in Phaedrus. We will see how Hamacher relates to it in a little bit, which presents the final hours and execution of Socrates, ultimately by those who were offended by his philosophical pursuit. So, mesology is a term which originates in the text. About Socrates giving in to being executed, no? For having misled the youth by teaching them philosophy rather than just sophistic discipline. So it relates to a hatred of reasoning and philology in the way that Hamacher presents it here is something similar. Now, he doesn't say it is mesology, but it is in touch with it. It is something similar, like it. it maintains the closest affinity with it. And with this, now we come to the third part of the lecture, the anarche, because it can maintain the closest affinity with mythology, but only an affinity because it is capable of beginnings. Philology is continuously capable of beginnings because essentially it is but an inclination. It is an intensification of an affect. It doesn't. It is not the positioning, the expositioning of a substance, of a thing, of something graspable, but it is a bit like a volcano, perhaps, yeah. Creating new ground. So, and in order to be able to do that, language must be in touch with itself. So language is not only, the language as philology relates to it, is not only a self that arrives back at itself as another, yet again, yeah? But rather language must be capable of an auto-affection. This is the pathos that he is talking about. Philology is pathology. It's an active suffering of this split, but this suffering is an auto-affection of language. So it's the site where a polemic is being carried out in a public space that resides within language itself. And within language itself, in all the words, this is also where there resides the unknown or the inconceivable. Yeah? So it's a kind of a polemics of the inconceivable with the inconceivable that is carried out in philology. He says, if language affects itself, this is because its self is split off through a crisis, a cutting off and a separating out precisely from the self as from another. And in doing so, language engages in permanent critique. The explicit disassociation and exclusion of the one self from the other, of the one language from the other, is an autocritique, a self-critique, but this self-critique is immediately a hetero-autocritique. Yeah. So hetero means many, many-fold, auto means self, so it's a many-fold self-critique. And this is what he calls a fundamental polemics, a transcendental dissensus. It is the uncircumventable form of the auto-affection of language and of its logical affect. Yeah. So this infinite form that the question can attain in philology and only in philology, this is an infinite form because it is characterized by the gesture of by language being auto-affective with itself, by being sensitive to what he picks up from Schlegel, a romantic philosopher, who was speaking of a logical affect, to say that logics doesn't only concern itself with form, but also there is an affection that relates to the logical form itself. This was a strong idea in Romanticism, but it was one where what Hamacher now begins to expose again as philology began to coincide with logics. So this is what happened in the 19th century. There was a movement which would claim that philology can coincide with logic, so that there can be a kind of a genealogy of logics which manifests philology as a science. And that is what Hamacher is trying to get distance to. So, but he picks up this notion of a logical affect, and he says it is indeed in philology where we can be affective to logics, but only because we are not concerning us with the statements of logics, because the form in which we can be sensitive to this affect is an infinite form. It is the form that questions can take only in philology. So philology becomes the site of such a, how did he call it, a fundamental polemics. Yeah. Philology will never provide foundations, but it is the site where there can be carried out a fundamental polemics. And this fundamental polemics comes from from the relation that is always playing together in logics, namely rhetorics and geometry. Yeah, rhetorics and geometry. They are the aim or the ambition, we could say, of form is precisely to bring them to a rest, to bring them to statements. So rhetorics is always creating dissensus, but also the possibilities for consensus, stasis, and geometry departs from states. Yeah? Geometry needs to stop time and depart from states. So, but then the two, if they could ever become close allies, then logics is strong. But philology, but they're not. So rhetorics is not with necessity, it is with opportunity. No? And because it is with opportunity, it will never silence time out of what it does. So it always challenges geometry. That means the forms for logics are never really at rest. And philology relates differently to the two. It relates to both of them in the affirmative. So it has a praxis of the geometrization of language, linear where it synthesizes, Hamacher says, cyclical where it reconstructs, and abstract where it establishes points of demarcation. But it also has an affirmative relation to rhetorics, because every one of these forms needs to be exploded again in philology through asking the question of the question. So philology is the polemically generative parody of its objects, the continual self-parody of language, he says. Yeah. So it affirms both the rhetorical part as well as the geometrical part, and because it does, all that is left for it to do is parody, to parody the questions which it picks up from elsewhere, the objects which it picks up. And this parody is at the core of a kind of a coding and of a masking and also a demasking and a revealing and of a making up that we will focus in the next lectures. So he picks up these words from Schlegel, as already mentioned, and he indeed has a very interesting formulation. He speaks of philology as a logical affect, the counterpart of philosophy, enthusiasm for chemical knowledge. Yeah? Enthusiasm for chemical knowledge. So knowledge as a Stofflichkeit, as a material, as a chemical thing, and an enthusiasm at the same time is... if you look at the dictionary, a description, an enthusiasm is an intense and eager enjoyment, interest, an eagerness, an ardor, a fervor, a warmth, a passion, a zeal, a zealousness, a zest. So an enthusiasm for chemical knowledge. So chemical is this material, diese Stofflichkeit, but an enthusiasm is a spiritedness with respect to it. And this picture, I think, captures well how philology can be affirmative both to the logos and its geometrization, as well as to rhetorics and its mechanization and its instrumentalization in relation to the logos. So in effect, language is not a system but a process, and one that propels itself beyond the permanent self-secession of speaking. So it depends cyclically, turning back to its first or authentic form, Then what this idea of the enthusiasm of the chemistry, which Schlegel proposes, leads to, consists in entering into and surpassing the movement of the cycle. So, and now, this is the point where Hamacher separates from Schlegel, if I am not mistaken here. But it seems to me, from what I know about these movements, is that the Romantics really were interested in seeking a complete polemic, whereas philology would accept as its own praxis the parody of all manners. No, but Hamacher is still citing Schlegel here. Okay, I'm not well familiar enough with Schlegel. Let's keep with the gesture. The gesture is what we are interested in. So out of this praxis as a parody, what is at stake is that all lines, all cycles, all points, the entire geometry that sets calculable limits to language, the entire logometry that fixes language into certain figures of succession, figures of the return into itself and figures of arrest into a distinct form, must be crushed, cut up, exploded, punctured, torn open and uncovered by the autopolemics of language, which is to say, by philology. They must be in a word parodied. So, and philology now is not only because it concerns itself with itself, it concerns itself with such parodies from both sides. Yeah. What is more, philology itself will have to become a praxis of the geometrization of language, linear where it synthesizes, cyclical where it reconstructs, and abstract where it establishes points of demarcation. And the same with the rhetorics. So it needs to relate to this to such parody in the sense of creating it, as well as in the sense of exploding it, puncturing it. We go a bit more quickly, we come to the final part of the lecture, providing for a language public. So what or how can one then proceed within such a fundamental polemics? How can one, what does philology do? Or how can philology apply geometrization and rhetorics to its own practice, so its own parodic praxis? Well, we saw in the beginning that at stake with philology is what Hamacher called structural irony. Yes, structural irony. So irony which is at work in the structure itself. So this is interesting, because usually there is a distinction between structure and form, whereas structure doesn't have time. No, structure imposes a timelessness, so a synchronicity as its starting point. A synchronicity which is different from the timelessness that comes with form. So it's also a timelessness that structure establishes. And if we speak of a structural irony, then there is no longer this synchronicity in structure, but rather whatever it is that a structure articulates can be in touch with itself. So it's something like a self. It's not a self. It's not a reflection. It's an hour. It's an autoaffection, or any of the words that Hamacher has used here. But what is important is that it introduces into the practice of such parody as he is describing introduces into structure a temporality. It's a kind of a tensedness of the synchronicity. And this tensedness now has other terms, which he describes through the idea of the stigma, so to be stigmatized. If there is a parody of the linguistic totality, and if philology is the parodistic trans-totality, then it is so only as the imminent doubling of a language of structures, functions, and operations through exactly the same language without structures, functions, and operations. So he says, irony, in the structural sense, it's what he calls a permanent parabasis. Parabasis, yes, I have this here, is a term from Greek theater, and it relates to an address in a play, to a direct address to the audience, sung or chanted by the chorus on behalf of the author. Yeah. So it's a direct address to the audience. So structural irony turns structure into a dramatical site, a theatrical site, where the author has the chorus speak out directly to the audience. This is a similar setup that we get with Hamacher's proposal of philology. Yeah. So this is interesting. I have not sorted this out, obviously, but this is so interesting because it reconnects us with tragedy. It reconnects us with what Ricardo Villo has been talking about with respect to tragedy stepping in as a substitute for sacrifice and the opening up of interpretation of scripture. Yeah. So what is at stake, what seems to be at stake with the way that Hamacher wants to introduce us to philology is something like this on a next level of abstraction. So Hamacher writes about philology. It is the escort of language and of the entirety of its productions, but it itself says nothing and produces nothing of its own. Yeah? So philology has an autonomy precisely because it relates to such a strange site of dramatization, which I will call the public, no, a language public. In the same sense, like the theater was something like public sacrifice, or I'm not sure if this is right now, but the analogies or the relations, they would be interesting to think through. Yeah, but what is at stake here? This I feel confident to say as an orientation of the lecture is a language public. And the language public wouldn't be either an arena or a theater stage or a marketplace, but any of it. So a civic public, which can accommodate knowledge in whatever architecture that makes up such a civic co-presence, coexistence place. Yeah, okay. Now we are coming to towards the end. We can recap some of the ideas. So if language doesn't have anything of its own, so philology is language not having anything to say of its own, and yet doing so with an autonomy. It's an autonomy which provides a kind of a public space. Then how does this work? How is such a public constituted? How, where does it come from? And it interestingly comes from a mechanism. It comes from a repetition which produces a voiding, which produces a decreation of fixed meanings. A decreation of fixed meanings through mechanical repetition. So it renders, if you want, language inoperative, so language in the tongues of particular disciplines are rendered inoperative and thereby make room for such a public. So this is an interesting thought to and I think one which can be which architecture shares with philology. I think this is one that architecture shares with philology, this mechanization as the mechanization as an opening, that is the strange thing, because it relates to the mechanization through a conspiration, we could say, between geometry and rhetorics. So that means the mechanization is affirmative to combine different gestures, different movements, the one of translation with the one of rotation, for example. So it's an interference in an established order, which is not going against the order, nor is it trying to support the order. It is doping it. It is adding a difference around which things can develop otherwise. This is again a recapture of what we said about parabasis, parody. A term which comprehends these gestures is paralogy. And paralogy and a paralogy, so this literally means a logos next to another logos. So it's like the parasite, one who eats next to the other. A speaking voice next to another speaking voice. This would be a paralogy. And this means there's a continuation, it's a logos which continues to speak, der sich fortspricht, is how Hamacher puts it, but it does not signify. Because it's a logos that goes next to another logos, it's not relative to something that it has to say. It just continues to speak. So they are strategies of such fortsprechen, of such continuation of speech. And this continuation of speech provides this strange kind of milieu or of medium in which there is it is possible to open up a public for coexisting interpretations of texts, we can say. No? And of course, everything can count as a text. But he speaks of a very peculiar moment here. He says, philology understood in this way is the epoche of the historical language world, even its own, for the benefit of another world. It empties out every given language in order to make room for others. But because it makes nothing other than room, philology is decreation. It is the medium in which all languages can speak, but which itself says nothing other than the beginning of saying. And the term epoche here is interesting, because epoche in ancient Greek means suspension of judgment. And here you can see, so we said, and we will see in the continuation of the lecture in a second part, how philology, so understood, becomes graspable as advocacy. It's the speaking in defense for the accused. That is the gesture, and in that, it cannot alone be responsible for a suspension of judgment. It's not within its control, but it is itself only if it helps, if it serves the possibility of a suspension of judgment. That is the outlook. And then this is the philosophical notion of epoche, but the secular notion of epoche, of course, refers to periods of time, yeah, an epoche. So as if there were a certain time, a zeitgeist, which would be one, which would be a consistent one, and which could be localized in time to have been effective or inactive between a certain moment or another. So this was our text for today. We will continue in a second lecture where we foreground the second part of this text. It is quite a long text and a very dense text, where this relation to advocacy will be worked out and brought to the foreground. For now, thank you very much for listening, and I look forward to our discussions.